Hello, let me introduce myself. My name's Keith. I'm the developer of the multi-platform retro game Chibi-Akamas, which I'm currently developing for the Amstrad CPC, ZX Spectrum and MSX2. Now, those are all Z80 systems, and what I'm going to do today is I'm going to teach you how to write a little program in Z80 assembly using the winape emulator. Now, this is going to be the first of a series of tutorials I'm going to be doing on how to begin Z80 development in assembly with absolutely no prior experience of programming, no prior experience of the Amstrad CPC, and I'm going to teach you in the fastest way that I believe you can get to writing your own games and hopefully enjoying developing for the Amstrad or any of the other Z80 systems. And the way I'm going to do it is I'm going to use my own source code as a template, both from teaching you how it works and teaching you how to take it apart and reuse it to make your own games very, very quickly. And so today we're going to start from the absolute beginning. I'm going to assume you haven't even got winape installed, and we're going to have a look at it. Now, please take a look at my website, which I'm going to link below, because all of today's lesson is going to be actually written in text with screenshots there. There's going to be plenty more information for you as well. And so let's begin. But this video will teach you everything, so feel free to start here and then move to the website to read it at your leisure. So let's just get rid of my little animation here, and let's actually have a look at what we've got. So winape is free. You can download it from the website I'll link below, and all you need is a Windows PC to run it. Now, if you don't have Windows, winape is fairly low requirements, so it runs great on Windows XP. You can probably find some old machine to run it on, or run it through some kind of emulator like a virtual PC, whatever you want. So let's have a start. Now, you're probably wondering, you're probably wondering why I'm recommending winape, and I will explain that to you. Now, winape isn't just an emulator. It's an emulator, it's an assembler, and it's a debugger, and they're all built into each other. And this is very good for the beginner, because firstly, if you have any problems, all three are in the same place, and it's a lot faster than if you've got separate programs, and one thing's doing your authoring, one thing's doing your compiling, and one thing's doing your emulation. And so by having them all together, if you have problems, you crash your machine, you need to recompile, you can do it in seconds. Also, the debugger and the assembler are second to none. They're absolutely superb. And the final thing is they all work together. You do your compiling, your label names all get copied through to your debugger. It works absolutely perfectly. So even if you've never used an Amstrad before and you don't want to compile for the Amstrad, you want to learn to program a Spectrum, winape's a great place to just get the very beginnings in Z80 and then move on to whatever you prefer to work with. But that said, I am actually programming all of my versions of Chibi-Akamas in winape, because the assembler can compile to simple files. What you choose to do with those files is up to you, so you can copy them to Spectrum disk images, and the Z80 code is the same wherever you compile it. So you don't need to worry about using a different assembler. If you finally decide, oh well, I'm going to program for the MSX, you can still use winape. So it's really the perfect place to start, and let's have a look at it today. So this is a fresh install of winape, so hopefully this will be exactly the same as you find it when you start it for the first time. And so here you get the blue screen, which is the Amstrad CPC's basic system, and I'm just going to make one slight change to the display options. And that's just, I'm going to turn off PAL emulation, which makes it look a little bit crisper. I kind of prefer that. And then we're going to go straight into the assembler. So we've just started using winape, and the first thing we're going to be doing is assembly programming. We're really going to move fast on this, so let's get started. So here's our assembly window. And we'll just meet, we don't need that, so let's move that out of the way. And we'll create a new file, and now we can start programming. So I've got a little program ready. It's a very simple program, but I'm going to start typing it in, and I'll explain it line by line as we do. So the first thing we're going to do an Orca command. Now, I should point out assembly isn't case sensitive in winape, so it doesn't particularly matter if you do uppercase or lowercase, so don't worry too much about that. And we're going to set org and 8000, and what this means is and 8000 is hexadecimal 8000, and that's the memory address that the code is going to compile to. And 8000 on an Amstrad CPC is kind of a spare area. You can't just compile anywhere, because you could end up overwriting the screen or the firmware. So you got to have the right place. But 8000 is going to be fine for any beginner programs you're doing. You really don't need to worry about it if you're putting it into that location. So our org and 8000. And then what we're going to do is we're going to do a command called ld a, 4. Now, I'll explain that command. LD is short for load, And A is a register called the accumulator. I'll explain what a register is. The ZX80 CPU has its own little pieces of built-in memory that it does that it uses for very quick operations. So the way you tend to work is you don't have many of these registers, but they're very fast. So you do your short bits of maths in these registers, and then you push it out to memory once you need the registers for something else. So you use these registers for your mathematics, and the accumulator is the main one that you really need for practically all mathematics. So That's the sort of brief introduction to our registers and things. All of this is in my text documentation, so it's probably I'm probably going a bit fast today, but please look at the text documentation. It's very, very detailed, and I really don't want to bore you with the full details of it today. So that's my accumulator there. Now we've loaded four into there, and the next command is going to be inc a. Now what that does is increment a by one. Inc always goes up by one. So we're taking that accumulator, which was previously four, and we're going to increase it by one, so it's going to be now five. And we'll actually make a comment, because we can make comments in assembly, and the comments don't do anything. They're just for our reference. The compiler completely ignores them. So we'll just write, A will now be five. And it's a good time for me to point out the source code for today's lesson and all the other ones I'll do in the future will be available from my website, and they are properly commented. I'm not properly commenting it today. I just want to be quick, and I'm hoping you're listening so that I don't need to type at the same time. So as I say, if you want to see what a properly commented thing would look like, please go to the website and download it. So anyway, we'll do another inc a. So as I said, it was previously five, it will now be six, and then we're going to do another load command, ld b comma 10. And what this does is it loads the B register, which is another less flexible register. It's not quite as powerful as the A register, but we've got more registers like B to work with. So we're going to put 10 into there. And what we're then going to do is we're going to do a command called add B. Now what this does is it loads B into A. And another way of putting this, and you can type this if you prefer, is add A comma B. Now, at this point, I'll explain. When you're working with Z80 Assembly, when you've got two commands, one on the left, one on the right, it always works that the one on the left is the destination and the one on the right is the source. So the way you kind of describe it is load 4 into A, load B into A. But as I said before, I've omitted the A from this one here. I've not mentioned A, and the reason for that is because the accumulator does practically all mathematics. It's kind of shorthand to omit it, because if you're adding B to nothing, as if you're not specifying where B is going, you can be pretty certain it would have to be the accumulator, because the accumulator does practically everything. So that's just some shorthand, and it would be clearer if I put add A comma B, but I haven't, because you'll really want to get used to the shorthand, because you'll be writing these things so often you'll want to save that time and that screen space. So as I say, you want to get used to the fact that if it doesn't say where it's going into the accumulator. So anyway, A was 6 and B is now 10, so A will now be 16. And then our last command is another load, but this one's a little different. And I'll just type it in and then I'll explain what it does. Okay, so what we've written here is load brackets and 7000 comma A. Now, as I said before, the thing on the right is the source and the thing on the left is the destination. And the brackets here mean the destination memory address. That's kind of what it means. So the fact that the brackets are there means you're loading the destination address 7000 with A rather than it being a number. I mean, you couldn't load a number 7000 with A, because it doesn't make any sense, because the 7000 would be a static. But as I say, with the brackets, it means the destination memory address 7000. And then our last command will be return, which is ret. And then that's our entire program today. Very, very simple program, just a beginner's program, but I think it's quite practical, and it'll allow us to have a look at some more stuff in winape. So let's do assemble here from the assemble menu, and I'll just bring this into frame. Now this is the results of the compilation, and you can see here in the middle you've got the bytecode that our little program has ended up as, but we don't need to worry about that. What we do need to worry about is, were there any errors? And the answer should be no. If it's not, you need to double check that you've typed the same thing as I did and make any corrections you need to. But if everything went okay, you just click OK here. And now this is the beauty of winape. This actually went straight into the memory of our emulator here. So now we can use a little Amstrad CPC command called call, C-A-L-L, turn caps lock off there. And we need an and symbol. and then 8000. Now the AND symbol, as I think I said before, means the hexadecimal address 8000, and we just hit enter, and that will run our program. And nothing happens, it just comes back to the basic command line and says ready. That just means we didn't crash, which is good. And that does mean our program ran okay. Now, what we want to do is we want to actually see what happened there. And this is where I think it's time for us to have a look at the debugger and learn how that works. So all we do is go back to our assembler here. And if we click on this gray space here, and it's the LDA,4 command, a little red blob will appear. And what this is it's a breakpoint. And then we need to recompile because we've put it into the assembler, and that will send the breakpoint over to our emulator. And this is a good point to show a little trick on the Amstrad CPC. If you hold down the shift key and press the up arrow, up cursor, you get this kind of second, you get this second cursor here, and then you can press the alt key, and that was actually marked as the copy key on the real CPC, and that will copy a previous line of text. If you don't want to do that, of course, you can just forget it, and you can just type it again. Call and 8000, and hit enter. And what happened there is our debugger has opened up, because as I said before, winape is a complete system. It's got everything you need to do development, and it's got a debugger. And what a debugger does is it shows you what the processor was doing at the time of that you stopped the emulator. And so what we're doing now is we're looking at what the actual Z80 processor was doing in the absolute most detailed possible sense. So let's have a look what this debugger is offering us, because it's offering us an awful lot. So on the left here, you've got the commands converted back to assembly language here, because this is the actual bytes in memory, but this is what those bytes mean. And sometimes it gets it wrong, but usually it's right, and it's all correct here. So let's have a look at it in a moment. And on the right here, you've got our registers. I mentioned before A and B, and you can see A here on the left-hand side and B here, and those are the two bytes that make up A, and those are the two bytes that make up B. And you're not just viewing here. If you want to make changes, you actually can. And there will be times where your program has had a problem and you need to quickly correct it to get it going again, or where you want to test it in a certain situation. And you can actually just type here. So you can, if I wanted to change A to 1 here, I just type, and that's immediately happened straight into the emulated Z80. And then at the bottom here, you've got the system memory, so you can browse the memory that the processor is currently seeing. You've got some advanced functions down here relating to ROM and other things, which I'm not going to go into today, it's too detailed. And then on the right here, bottom right, you've got the stack here. The stack's very important, but again, a bit too detailed, so we're not going to go into it this lesson, but I will cover it next time. So, it's not just what you see here, you've got even more options. You can right click and you'll find loads of great options here as well. But I'm not going to go into them. Feel free to play around with this. You've got to bear in mind this is an emulated machine. You don't need to worry about causing a crash, because the worst you can crash is the emulated machine. And if you do crash it, all you do is recompile your code back in into the memory, because if it crashes, the memory will be erased. But you just compile in, carry on again. That's the beauty of testing on this WinApe, and with all of the things linked straight together, you can code, crash, recode, fix, all very quickly. Saves you a lot of time as a beginner, because you're going to make a lot of mistakes, you're going to cause a lot of crashes, and it's nothing to be worried about. So this is our emulator here, and then what we're going to do in our debugger is we're going to step through, and we can do this by pressing the F7 key or by pressing this footprint here. And what that does is it makes the Z80 do one command, so we can see every single command that the Z80 is running and how that is affecting the whole system. So what I want you to have a look at is the A register here, and also B here, because these are the two that our code is going to change. So the first command is going to load 4 into A, and then let's just press this footprint, and look, you can see it just happened. 4 has been loaded into A. And when we press again, it's going to be incremented, or at least hope we expect it to be incremented. Let's see. And yes, it did. One more time. And now we're up to 6. And now we're going to load, if you remember, we're going to load 10 into B. But this is working in hexadecimal. If you're not familiar with hexadecimal, I've written what I think is a nice tutorial on how it works on my website. I've tried to be brief, but I've tried to tell you everything you need to know. But basically, hexadecimal, we normally work in base 10, which goes 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 0. But what this is base 16, it goes up to 9, and then it goes A, B, C, D, E, F. And so 10 is A. A bit weird, I don't know, but it's the way the computers work, so you do have to understand it. If you get stuck with it, Windows calculator's got a programmer mode. you can always sort yourself out with that, and just understand if you're looking at something of what's D4 mean in normal numbers, get Windows Calculator to help you out. So okay, let's carry on anyway. So you can see now B has been loaded with A, which is 10, as I said, and then we're going to add B, the A, to the accumulator, which was 6, and we'll just step in again and we'll see that happen. So again, a rather odd trick of hexadecimal. 16 is 10, because as I said before, it goes A, B, C, D, E, F, and when it gets to F, which is 15, you add 1 and then it goes to 10. I know that's probably kind of scaring a few people, but really don't worry about it. You get used to it quite quickly. It's just unusual when you've not seen it before, but don't worry about it. And then our final command was that load command, which is going to load to hexadecimal memory location 7000, and it's going to put the accumulator in there. So we're going to do another step now and we'll see that happen. And it's happened. We'll trust it's happened for now. And then we're going to press one more time and do the return command. And maybe this is going to surprise you, because maybe you're thinking it's going to return to basic. And it kind of does, but not how you'd think. We're still in the debugger. What's happened here? Well, I'll explain. The basic programming language is part of the Amstrad CPC, part of the firmware. And we're debugging the whole CPC, not just our code. So we're now debugging the firmware itself. And maybe you want to do that. There were times when that's great to do, to see how the firmware is working, how the interrupt handlers are working, because that might be what's causing your code's problem. But today, far beyond what we want to do. So we're just going to close our debugger here. And we see, we go back to basic again, brilliant. Now, if you ever, at any point, you want to go into the debugger at an arbitrary point for any reason, well, you can just press the pause button down here, or you can go to the debug menu and select pause. And here's our debugger again. And the one last thing we want to do is we want to have a look at the memory, because if you remember, I said it was loading into 7000. And our memory's down here, and you can scroll up and down here to find it, or you can right click and use one of these more advanced functions and select go to. Just get that into frame for you and type in 7000. And what do we have here? We have 10, which, if you remember, was the final memory, the final value we expected the accumulator to have. And there we go. So our program has run fine. Now, I know that's a fairly simple program. You probably would like to see some more impressive stuff, but I really want to start with the basics of just mathematics. And we're going to go into some more stuff later, and I'll teach you some much cleverer stuff later. You might be looking at this thinking, oh grief, if that's how much work it takes to just do a few bits of maths, writing a whole game is going to be crazy. And okay, I mean, that's kind of true, but you've got to bear in mind, you don't need to code it all yourself. Once you understand the basics, the addition, the subtraction, the memory commands, you can borrow other people's code. I didn't write any of the music software that my game uses. I just used Arcos Tracker, and as soon as you know how to interface it, you can just go away with it. And what I'm going to do over the following lessons is I'm going to teach you to how actually modify my game, or use parts of my game to make your own unique game yourself, with virtually no programming at all, or as much programming as you want to do. If you want to use my sprite routines, you're welcome to, and I'll show you how to do it. If you want to just tweak my game and make the game rules a bit different, I'll show you how to do that too. So you can do as much or as little, and you can create something unique and hopefully enjoyable for yourself and for others with really very little programming. And all you need to do is learn the basic commands. And to be honest, assembly is beautiful because it has so few commands. There's so little you need to learn before you know everything. And then you can just jump right in and create as much or as little as you feel like creating. So that was my tutorial today. As I said before, please check out my website, because these videos are actually kind of just a quick covering of this content. I'm going into far more detail on the same code fragments on my website. I've also got a Patreon account if you want to support me making these, or if you want to learn more, because my Patreon account does actually cover the multi-platform development I'm doing on my new games that are coming out. So please think about doing that. I hope you've learned something today. I hope you've enjoyed it, and please let me know if you want to see more, or what you want to see me do next. Thanks for watching today. Goodbye.